Pro Electrician, number 10. This chapter is on transformers. Here shown are the technical terms for this chapter and the objectives. For economic reasons, power is transmitted from the utility generating station to the consumer at high voltages and low currents. This permits the use of smaller wire sizes. A transformer is a device that converts electrical power from one voltage and current to another voltage and current. Transformer theory. As shown on the screen, the transformer is made up of three parts: a primary coil, a core, a secondary coil. All three parts are stationary. The operation of a transformer depends on magnetic fields rather than mechanical movement. The two separate coils or windings are wrapped around a core. The magnetic core is normally made of iron or bound steel strips. When current is applied to one of the windings, an alternating magnetic field is created in the core. This magnetic field causes current to flow in the other winding. This principle is called induction. It is the basis of transformer operation. The primary winding is energized with current and produces the magnetic field. The secondary winding produces current induced by the magnetic field. For this, see figure 10-1 shown on the screen, left side. Windings are normally referred to as high voltage or low voltage rather than primary or secondary. Again, high voltage is usually your primary, low voltage is usually your secondary, although not all the time. High voltage terminals, again your primaries, are marked H, H1, H2, and so on, while low voltage terminals are marked X, X1, X2, etc. There is a direct relationship, the voltage ratio, between the voltage in the primary winding and the voltage in the secondary winding. The number of turns of wire in each coil determines the ratio. For example, if a transformer has a 10 to 1 voltage ratio, the coil has 10 times as many turns of wire as the other. This winding will produce 10 times the voltage of the other winding. That's in theory. The voltage ratio is also referred to as the turns ratio. If the primary coil has more turns than the secondary coil, the primary voltage will be greater than the secondary voltage. This type of transformer is called a step-down transformer because the voltage leaving the transformer is less than the voltage supplied. A step-up transformer has more turns in the secondary coil and produces a voltage higher than the input voltage. Power rating. Transformer power is designated in units of volt amperes or VAs, or more commonly kilovolt amperes, KVA. The mathematical formula for power was presented in chapter 1 of this text. Power equals voltage times current. P equals E times I. In a transformer, the current and voltage are different for each winding. However, the power is identical for both windings. To compute the power of a transformer, multiply the voltage and current of the primary or the secondary winding. For single-phase transformers, the following formulas can be used, where power equals to voltage on the primary times the current in the primary, or power equals to voltage in the secondary times the current in the secondary. In the case of three-phase transformers, multiply the voltage by 1.732 before calculating the power. The power rating of a transformer indicates the maximum allowable power. Figure 10-2 contains tables of full load currents for various transformers and voltages. Here's the second part of that figure, figure 10-2. To move on to the sample problem 10-1, what is the full load current limit for a 5 kVA transformer supplying a 120 volt secondary. For this, rearrange the formula P equals E times I, that is power equals power or voltage times current. Solve for current. Rearrange it as current equals power divided voltage. For the solution, solve for the currents using the values of voltage and power. However, the power and voltage values are expressed in different units, so they must be converted to similar units. So 1 kVA is equal to 1,000 VAs, and 5 kVA equals to 5,000 VA. Now that the units agree, the numbers can be put into the formula, plug in the values, and we divide 5,000 VA by 120 volts, and we get 41.67 amps. The full load current for this transformer is 41.67 amps. Impedance. The impedance of a transformer is an indication of the short circuit current delivered when a direct short is placed across the secondary terminals. Again, the impedance of a transformer is an indication of the short circuit current delivered when the direct short is placed across the secondary terminals. The impedance factor is listed as a percentage on the transformer nameplate. This factor is used in sizing overcurrent protective devices. The transformer's available secondary short circuit current, or ASC, is computed by dividing the secondary full load current, FLC, by the impedance, Z, and then multiplying it by 100%. This is the formula of impedance expressed as a percentage shown on the screen now. Take note of it, it's very important. Moving on to sample problem 10-2. A 50 kVA transformer has a single phase secondary voltage of 240 volts and an impedance of 5%. What is the available secondary short circuit current? Using the formula, current equals to power divided by voltage. So the ASC, that is the available secondary short circuit current, equals to FLC full load current times 100% divided by Z, or the impedance. That is the formula that we'll use, the solution. First, the secondary full load current must be determined. So this is computed by using the power and the voltage. So we get 208.3 amps in that case. So the available short circuit secondary current is calculated using the formula ASC equals to FLC times 100% divided by Z, or impedance. So in this case, we plug in the values 208.3 amps times 100% divided by 5%. We ultimately get 4166 amps. Or 4,166 amps. The available secondary short circuit current is 4,166 amps. This means that the overcurrent device or breaker or fuse, which must be sized and rated to protect the circuit adequately, should be 225 amps with a short circuit withstand of at least 5,000 amps. Voltage, current, and impedance calculations. The table in figure 10-3 shows the algebraic equations relating voltage, current, and impedance in a transformer. Notice how the voltage, current, and power are related. Voltage is directly proportional to the number of turns. Current is inversely proportional to the voltage and the number of turns. And power is equal in each of the windings. very important concepts. So we'll do problem 10-3. A transformer is provided with a 180 volt source and must supply 120 volts and 30 amps. What is the required primary current? So we know the primary voltage, or EP. We know the secondary voltage, or ES. And we know the secondary current, IS. And we want to determine the primary current, that is IP. In the current column of figure 10-3, find the equation for IP using the known variables. So going to the transformer formulas, we look for the equation showing IP equals ES times IS divided by EP. So we plug in the values. In this case, 120 volts times 30 amps divided by 480 volts. Or 7.5 amps. So the primary current is 7.5 amps. Move on to sample problem 10-4. A transformer with a primary winding with 500 turns and a secondary winding with 250 turns is connected to a 480 volt source. What voltage is produced on the secondary side? For this, we know that NP, NS, and EP. We know those values, and we want to determine ES, so going to table 10-3, we look for the equation where ES is on the left side. So using the equation from the table, we find that ES equals EP times NS divided by NP. We plug in the values, 480 volts times 250 divided by 500. In this case, we get 240 volts. So the secondary side would supply 240 volts. Sample problem 10-5, a transformer has a primary coil with 2500 turns and a secondary coil with 500 turns. It must deliver 25 amps to its load side. What current should be supplied to the transformer? So the solution is using an equation from the table, 10-3, the one that has IP on the left side, that's the current primary. We find that we can use the formula that says current secondary times the number of turns on the secondary divided by the number of turns in the primary. We plug in the values, in this case 25 amps times 500 divided by 2500. Ultimately, we get 5 amps, so the transformer should be supplied with a current of 5 amps. A transformer adjusts to meet the requirements of the load side current. When no current is being used on the load side, no current flows in the primary, except a very small amount needed to maintain the magnetic field. Shown is, again, table of transformer formulas, a very important table. I suggest that you either find it, keep it, where it's accessible if you work or you plan to work with, on, or around transformers. Very important, especially with manufacturing and design of transformers, or circuit designs which include transformers. Transformer efficiency. Transformers are highly efficient, but they do have some losses. These losses are due to heating and power consumption within the components of the transformer. So two kinds of losses are inherent with transformers. Both are small, but they are always present. First is the core loss. This type of loss is independent of the load supplied by the transformer. It occurs due to the power consumed in creating the magnetic flux. This power loss is about 1% of the transformer power rating. The second one is copper loss. This type of loss is also referred to as heat loss or resistance loss, and I squared R loss. It is caused by resistance of the in the windings and is numerically equal to I squared times resistance, or current squared times resistance. This loss varies with the square of the current and is normally less than 2% of the transformer power rating. Jumping on to sample problem 10-6. If a transformer has a winding resistance of 4 ohms and a load current of 6 amperes, what is the copper loss? For the solution, using the formula presented in the previous discussion, the copper loss, or I, equals to current squared times resistance, in this case 6 amps squared times 4 ohms, we get 144 VAs, volt amperes. So the copper loss is 144 volt amperes. The copper loss and core loss are combined and compared to the overall transformer power rating to determine the efficiency of the transformer, using, of course, the formula shown on the screen. So the efficiency is normally listed on the transformer nameplate. Transformer varieties. Transformers are identified and classified in many ways: the construction type, the construction, the type of cooling system, the winding connections, and the usage may be used to describe a given transformer and to differentiate it from other transformers. Transformers can be classified as dry type or liquid insulated. This classification is based on whether or not the transformer core and windings are submerged in an insulating liquid. In dry type transformers, air surrounds the core and windings. Ventilation openings in the transformer enclosure allow air to flow through the transformer, dissipating the heat produced by the windings. Larger transformers use a blower to circulate more air through the enclosure. The core and windings of a liquid insulated transformers are enclosed in a sealed tank filled with liquid. The liquid serves as an insulator between the components and also provides a medium for heat to be dissipated. Heat is transferred from the windings through the liquid to the tank. The air in contact with the outer tank surface then removes the heat. Small liquid insulated transformers have a smooth tank. Tanks on larger transformers have fins or external radiators to provide a larger surface in contact with the air. The larger contact surface allows heat to dissipate more quickly. A blower can also be used to circulate air around the tank. A sensor measuring oil temperature operates a thermostat in the blower circuit. So moving on to sample problem 10-7, a 50 kVA transformer has a copper loss of 0.45 kVA and a core loss of 0.35 kVA. So determine the efficiency of the transformer. For this, first the core and copper losses are combined to determine the total losses. So the total losses equals to, in this case, 0.45 kVA plus 0.35 kVA or 0.80 kVA in total. The output power is the nominal power rating of the transformer. The input power is the output power plus the total losses. From these values, efficiency is computed. So the output power is 50 kVA. The input power is 50 kVA plus 0.80 kVA or 50.8. So for the efficiency, we use the formula efficiency equals to output divided by input times 100%. In this case, 50 kVA divided by 50.8 kVA times 100, or 98.4%. So the transformer efficiency in this case is 98.4%. NEC note 450.9, the ventilation shall be adequate to dispose of the transformer full load losses without creating temperature rise that is in excess of the transformer rating. The liquid in the transformer adds additional weight to liquid insulated transformers. making them heavier than comparable dry type transformers. Also, extra precautions must be taken to check for leaks when installing liquid insulated transformers. In the past, liquid insulated transformers contained either oil or Ascarel, a type of non-flammable oil. However, Ascarel filled transformers are no longer used due to environmental hazards. They have been replaced with less flammable liquid insulated transformers. The insulating liquid in these transformers may burn, but flames will not spread from the point of ignition. Transformers can also be classified by their windings. In an isolation transformer, the primary and secondary windings are physically separate and independent of one another. In an auto transformer, there is only one winding, which is shared by the primary and secondary circuits. For this, see figure 10-4. This type of transformer is used when voltage reduction is needed, for example, starting AC motors. Though economical to manufacture and very efficient, the auto transformers are limited in application due to their low voltage ratios. There are several other types of transformers that are more specialized in their design and application than basic isolation transformers and auto transformers. These include potential transformers, current transformers, constant current transformers, and controlled transformers. Potential transformers, or PTs. These step-down transformers are used to operate measuring instruments such as voltmeters and wattmeters. The secondary voltage is a percentage of the primary voltage and is normally 120 volts. This type of transformer is illustrated on the screen now, 10-5. The current transformers, or CTs. Current transformers are used for reducing high current. Like potential transformers, they are used with instruments. The primary of a current transformer, or CT, is connected in series with the high voltage line. The secondary current is proportional to the primary current and is usually designed to be 5 amps. Current and potential transformers are used together. See the figure on the screen now, 10-6. Constant current transformers. Constant current transformers maintain an unchanging current on the secondary side, even if the load demand varies, regardless of the changes, of what changes take place among the operating devices of the secondary side. The constant current transformer will maintain the same delivered current within a 1% tolerance at all times. Finally, control transformers. Control transformers reduce the primary voltage to 120 volts or less on the secondary. The secondary is used to operate solenoids, relays, and contactors of a step-down transformer. Sometimes these transformers are incorrectly referred to as signal or instrument transformers. NEC Note 450.21b. Unless otherwise specified in this article, the term fire resistant means a construction having a minimum fire rating of 1 hour. Transformer installation. Most of the code requirements for transformer installation are found in Part 2 of Article 450. These requirements are mainly concerned with preventing a transformer fire from spreading onto a building or other combustible material. Provisions vary depending on the transformer type, its voltage rating, and whether it's installed indoors or outdoors. Transformers should be located in such manner that they will not be physically damaged, exposed to severe weather, or be liable to having foreign objects inserted into them. Ventilation openings must not be blocked by walls or other obstructions. Transformers must be located where they are easily accessible. If the transformer is concealed or obstructed, maintenance will be difficult. Dry type transformer location. Dry type transformers located outdoors must have a weatherproof enclosure. In addition, transformers rated above 112.5 kVA must be located at least 12 inches away from the building. That is probably, there's a typo in the book there, that is probably a 12-foot, most likely 12-foot clearance away from the buildings and combustible materials. This clearance may be reduced if the requirements of section 450.22 of the code are met. When installed indoors, dry type transformers over 35,000 volts must be installed in a transformer vault. Transformers rated 112.5 kVAs or higher must be installed in a transformer room of fire resistance construction. Transformers with a lower rating must have a 12-inch clearance. Again, most likely a 12-foot clearance from any part of the building or combustible materials unless rated for 600 volts or less and completely enclosed except for ventilation openings. In accordance to section 450.13, dry type transformers with a voltage rating less than 600 volts do not need to be readily accessible in the following situations. The transformer is located in the open on a wall or column. The power rating does not exceed 50 kVA and the transformer is located with proper ventilation in a fire resistant hollow space that is not permanently enclosed in the structure. Liquid insulated transformer locations. Special precautions are needed when an oil insulated transformer is installed outdoors near a building or on a roof. Any nearby buildings and combustible materials must be protected in case of fire. This protection can be any or a combination of the following, shown on the screen now. Sufficient distance from the transformer is the first. Second, automatic fire protection systems such as sprinklers. Third, fire resistant barriers. And fourth, enclosure to contain spilled oil such as a curved area or trench. Normally, oil insulated transformers installed indoors must be located in a transformer vault. There are exceptions listed in section 450.26 including the following. First, no vault is needed for transformers rated less than 600 volts if the total transformer capacity in one location is less than 75 kVA for fire resistant areas or 10 kVA for combustible areas, and if proper measures are taken to ensure that an oil fire cannot ignite other materials. And the second is that no vault is needed if the transformer is located in a detached building used only for supplying electrical service accessible to qualified personnel only with contents that would not create a hazard in the event of fire. Less flammable liquid insulated transformers rated less than 35,000 volts do not require a transformer vault if protected by an automatic fire extinguishing system, provided with liquid containment area and located away from combustible materials. If the transformer is rated over 35 kVAs and installed indoors, it must be located in a transformer vault. Notes: where protected, by an acceptable automatic fire extinguisher system, walls, ceilings, floors, and doors, with 1 hour fire rated or fire resistance construction are allowed. Transformer vaults. Transformer vaults are designed to contain transformer oil spills and prevent fire from escaping in a confined area. When installed indoors, all transformers rated over 35,000 volts and many rated under 35,000 volts must be installed in a vault. The code addresses transformer vaults in Part 3 of Article 450. The walls, ceilings, and floor of a transformer vault must be constructed of material with a minimum of 3 hour fire rating. If the floor rests on earth, it must be at least 4 inches thick. Interior doors must be tight fitting with a 3 hour fire resistance. The sill below the door must be high enough to contain the amount of oil in the largest transformer with a 4 inch minimum. Doors must swing out from the vault and must be locked, with only qualified personnel having access. Sufficient ventilation must be provided to keep transformer temperatures at an acceptable level. Vents should be located as far as possible from doors, windows, and combustible materials. Whenever possible, vaults should be located so that they are ventilated with fresh air without the use of ducts and flues. Ventilation openings between the vault and the building must have at least 1.5 hours fire resistant dampers that automatically close in the event of a fire. Materials should not be stored in a transformer vault. Pipes and ducts that are not related to the vault should not pass through the vault. Grounding. All non-current carrying metals or metal parts of the transformer, including the enclosure, must be bonded together and properly grounded. Section 250.110 provides the requirements for grounding fastened equipment. Grounding points on the secondary windings are shown in Figure 10-7. The winding cannot be grounded by connecting the neutral to the enclosure. NEC Note 450.10, where grounded, exposed non-current carrying metal parts of transformer installations, including fences, guards, and so forth, shall be grounded and bonded under the conditions and in the manner specified for electrical equipment and other exposed metal parts in parts 5, 6, and 7 of Article 250. Note, grounding is discussed in Chapter 11 of this text. Overcurrent protection. Transformers require overcurrent protection. General requirements for transformer overcurrent protection are specified in Section 450.3 of the Code. Normally, separate overcurrent protection devices are required for the transformer primary and secondary. The device rating is based on the current rating of the primary or secondary. The sizing requirements are different for transformers rated over 600 volts and for transformers rated 600 volts or less. Note, these overcurrent protection requirements are for the transformer only. The conductors connected to the transformer, primary and secondary, must have overcurrent protection as specified in Article 240 and 310. Transformers rated over 600 volts. Both primary and secondary overcurrent protected devices are normally required for transformers rated over 600 volts. The maximum allowable settings for the overcurrent devices depend on the rated transformer impedance, the type of device used, and the rated voltage of the secondary. Again, the maximum allowable settings of the overcurrent protective overcurrent devices depend on the rated transformer impedance, the type of device used, and the rated voltage of the secondary. Figure 10-8 on the screen now, which is a reproduction of table 450.3A of the code. If the required rating does not correspond to a standard device rating, the next higher device rating may be used. That is for overcurrent device or devices. Normally, overcurrent protection is required for both the transformer primary and secondary. The required overcurrent protective device ratings or rating depends on the rated impedance of the transformer. If the rated impedance is 6% or less, higher circuit breaker or fuse ratings are allowed. If the transformer is located in a supervised location, secondary overcurrent protection may not be necessary. If the primary overcurrent protection has a maximum setting of 300% for circuit breakers or 250% for fuses. Also, secondary overcurrent protection may be omitted if the transformer is supervised and equipped with coordinated thermal overload protection. Note 3 in table 450.3A defines supervised locations. Note, check with the authority having jurisdiction, your AHJ, regarding the supervised transformer installations. Their definition of supervised may differ from yours or from the NEC. Is their decision to determine the requirements. Transformers rated 600 volts or less. Section 450.3B of the code addresses overcurrent protection for transformers rated 600 volts or less. Carefully review this section of the code. There are different protection arrangements depending on conditions and transformer ratings. The protective device ratings depend on two factors: the protection method, primary and secondary, and the current rating of the transformer. See figure 10-9 shown on the screen now. For primary protection only, the overcurrent protective device of the transformer primary must be rated at the value shown on the first row of the table, 450.3B. If the required rating does not correspond to a standard device rating, the next higher rating may be used. If the overcurrent protection for the primary feeder circuit satisfies this requirement, individual circuit protection for the transformer is not required. Secondly, primary and secondary protection. The bottom row of table 450.3B lists overcurrent protective device settings for transformers with primary and secondary protection. Again, for primary and secondary protection, the bottom row of table 450.3B lists overcurrent protective device settings for transformers with primary and secondary protection. The primary devices can have higher ratings than allowed for primary-only protection. Notes: requirements for overcurrent protection of auto transformers can be found in section 450.4, that is section 450.4 and section 450.5 of the code. Overcurrent protection requirements for secondary ties are found in section 450.6B. Jumping on to problem 10-8, sample problem. What size fuses are required to protect the primary side of a single phase 4160 volt 120 kVA transformer with a supervised or in a supervised location with no individual secondary overcurrent protection provided? So the solution: first, converts the power from kVA to VAs, that is 120,000 VAs. So solving for the power formula, where power equals to voltage times current. You solve for I, you rearrange that, where current equals to power divided voltage, in this case 120,000 VAs, divided by 4,160 volts, gives us 28.8 amps. From table 450.3A, the fuse rating for the primary is 250%, as shown on the next page. So the required fuse rating can be found by multiplying the voltage times 2.5, or 250%. So the fuse rating is 28.8 amps times 2.5, or 72 amps. Because this is not a standard fuse size, 72 amps, see section 240.6, the next higher standard fuse is, there's the typo in the book, I believe, and the correct answer is 80 amps, excuse me. Again, the text says 90 amps, but I believe is 80 amps. Jumping on to sample problem 10-9. What size fuses are needed to protect a single phase 2 kVA transformer with a rated primary voltage of 240 volts? No additional overcurrent protection provided for the transformer secondary. So first, determine the current using the formula current equals to power divided voltage, in this case 2000 VAs, and divided by 240 volts, or 8.3 amps. So the transformer voltage is less than 600 volts in this case, and the current is less than 9 amps. So using table 450.3b to determine the fuse rating, we get a fuse size. So the fuse cannot be larger, according to the table, cannot be larger than 167% of the primary current. So the fuse size is, in this case, 8.3 amps. So you multiply that by 1.67, that is 167%, we get 13.9 amps. So 13.9 amps is not a standard size, so the next higher standard size is 15 amps, which is the size used. Transformer connections and wiring diagrams. A single phase 3 wire system is used for most residential and commercial installations. This type of service has several advantages. First, there are two voltages available, 120 for lighting and small appliances loads, and 240 volts for heavy appliance and motor loads. Second, the system uses 35% less copper than a two wire 120 volt system having the same rating and transforming efficiency. Third, the current can be balanced between the neutral and either of the two hot conductors, thus voltage drop is minimized and the voltage is more constant at the load end of the circuit. Most electrical energy is transmitted by three-phase AC generating devices. Three-phase transformers can be used to transform the voltages of three-phase systems to single-phase current. There are several types of these transformers, see figure 10-10, delta-delta, Y-Y, delta-Y, Y-delta, and open-delta. Moving on to sample problem 10-10. A three-phase transformer is rated at 15 kVAs, that's 15,000 VAs, supplied with 480 volts, and supplies power for a 120/208 volt lighting panel with a continuous load of 30 amps. What size overcurrent device or overcurrent protective device is needed for primary only protection? For the solution, first convert the power from kilovolt amperes to volt amperes, in this case 15,000 VAs. Because this is a three-phase current, transformer, the actual voltage is 1.732 times the nominal voltage, or using the formula, power equals to 1.732 times 480 volts, we get 831 volts. Then determine the primary current using the formula, the Ohm's law formula, or the Watt's law formula, where current equals to power divided by voltage, in this case 15,000 VAs divided by 831 volts. We get 18 amps as the current. So using table 450.3b, which states that primary overcurrent protection for the transformer is to be rated at no more than 125% of the rated primary current for currents greater than 9 amps. So the fuse rating in this case is 18 amps. We multiply that by 1.25, which is 125%, we get 22.5 amps. So the next highest standard fuse size in this case is 25 amps, and that's what we use. Sample problem 10-11. What is the primary and secondary currents ratings of a 500 kVA three-phase step-down transformer reducing a 480 volt delta to a 120/208 volt Y? We see a nice illustration of this situation. And the solution, we determine the actual voltage in three phases, which is the voltage equals to 480 volts times 1.732, or 831 volts. Next, we convert the power to units of volt amperes. So 500 kVAs in this case, we get 500,000 VAs. Next, we find the current on the delta primary side. We use the Watt's formula, where current equals to power divided by voltage, in this case 500,000 divided by 831 volts. We get 602 amps. So to determine the current for the Y secondary, first calculate the three-phase voltage, in this case 208 volts times 1.732, we get 360 volts. Then the current is calculated using the Watt formula. Current equals to power divided by voltage, or 500,000 divided 360 volts, we get in this case 1389 amps. The primary current is 602 amps, and the secondary current in this case is 1389 amps, or 1389 amps. Moving on to the last sample problem of this chapter, 10-12. A single phase 50 kVA transformer has a 480 volt primary and a 240 volt secondary. What are their primary and secondary current ratings of this transformer? So we convert power from kilovolt amperes to volt amperes. We get in this case 50,000 VAs. Then we calculate the primary and secondary currents using the Watt's formula again, slightly modified as current on the primary equals to power divided by the voltage of the primary. In this case, we get 50,000 VAs divided by 480 volts, or 104 amps. Next, we move on to the secondary Watt's formula, modified to the secondary, where current secondary equals to power divided by voltage on the secondary, in this case 50,000 VAs divided by 240 volts equals to 208 amps. So the primary current is 104 amps and the secondary current is 208 amps. Remember that power remains the same theoretically within the transformer. So when you increase your voltage, you decrease your amperage. As you decrease your voltage, you increase your amperage. That is always the case. Jumping on to review questions for this chapter. All important review questions. Do make sure that you read every one of these questions and answers and attempt to answer them on your own if you so wish. We do highly recommend it. I do highly recommend it. And do become familiar with these questions and answers. The more you work problems out, the more familiar you will become, not only finding information but working out problems and deducing and tackling and solving problems dealing with electrical circuits, transformers, and many other types of electrical problems. Here are the rest of the questions and answers. Again, some answers may just be references to the text. Do follow those up. Here's a fill-in-the-blank table. Some of the problems have been worked out. As you can see, some of them just have answers. Do go back and try to match these answers. Some of them you may find may need to be corrected. Again, I am not infallible, so I do recommend you do work these on your own and to verify that they are correct. Here are the rest of the questions, the worked problems and answers, including using the NEC questions. Again, using the NEC is a section that allows you to get familiar with looking for information in the National Electrical Code. This text depends on the 2011 version. You may have a later version. As of the writing of this text, the 2017 version is out, and we do recommend you use the latest version. You can pause the video, rewind as you may see fit. This has been a section or lesson on transformers. Thank you very much for listening and reading and watching. Do look forward to try to get your attention to the next lesson. Do look for that online. Thank you.